I can't predict. This could stay like this for the next 1 year, and this may cause a detachment tomorrow morning. So even I can't even tell you that you can stay till tomorrow, but at the same time, I'm not telling you that it's going to detach. This could stay okay for years on an end. And I am not going to become a liar in your eyes by giving you either of the predictions. Because I tell you that this is going to detach in 2-3 days, you come back after 4 days and say, doctor's a liar. The reverse happens, I tell you that nothing is going to happen in 4 days and you detach. And then you're going to tell me, you're responsible for my detachment. So the choice is yours. Having seen this, I will not say either way, but it is better to get this treated. And as he said, I will add this point that it's a quick, slow procedure. It's not an issue.
Exactly. So ideally, it's a very small procedure and needs to be done as early as possible. That is what you tell your patient. And what kind of follow-up would we ask your patients to do after this? Dr. Nitin?
It's a simple HST. I generally tell them to come back in a week's time, unless there's a sudden aggravation of the floaters or flashes. Then I would ask them to come back earlier. I would tell them flashes will persist, like Dr. Dinesh had mentioned. Floaters also are going to be there, but if there's a sudden increase or a different characteristic of those flashes, come back earlier. Otherwise, I see them after a week again. Then probably I may need to see you back after 3-4 weeks again after that.
Now, a similar patient goes, he is treated by Nitin, he shifts to Pune and he goes to Salil's clinic. And Salil sees that, well, he's come back with fresh flashes and floaters. He sees that this is the tear which has been treated. And in this tear, well, there are a few laser marks which I have taken up. Can you have the pointer here? Okay. Yeah. A few laser marks have been taken up, but there is a little bit of fluid over here. There are these laser marks, there are these uncovered areas. So, Salil, if you see this patient who came to you 3 months later, Nitin had treated him 3 months ago, he came with fresh flashes and floaters, and you see this, you feel that this treatment may be a little inadequate. What would you tell this patient?
The first thing that I would tell the patient is that the treatment which he has received is a very good treatment and very adequately the doctor has treated
exactly.
him at that time.
Thanks, Salil.
No, I think that is, I'm very frank. This is what we have noticed, at least in the retina fraternity. I don't know what is the reason for that, but we all have that sort of a feeling amongst us that, at least in Pune, we have whatever 5-7 vitro retina surgeons who are very active. We never have a situation that it was, that's the first, because, I think for a VR surgeon, you know that it could have been your patient as well, who could, what I'm first telling is that it's been done very well, it has been adequately treated, but the possibility is that the disease process has slightly progressed in the last 3 months because of the basic kind of pathology that it is. So to make it a little better, we will just give one more, this thing will cover up the areas that need to be treated, and that's the way I think I would counsel.
Okay, I would deal it a little differently, saying that it's adequate means the guy says, okay, then why do I need more treatment? So I will normally, what I would say is that, look, when you laser, what you're doing is creating a dam. The dam can be a small dam, it can be a big dam. Personally, I would prefer the dam to be much bigger, but the dam is there. This is an individual choice. Somebody makes a little smaller dam, someone makes a little bigger dam. So while the dam is there, the dam is covering that, I would feel more comfortable if I increase the size of the dam. So that's the reason for doing more laser. That gives both the points that, look, you want to increase the safety, because the moment you say it's adequate, my problem is then he'll say,
what the way I would handle it is, I would say the treatment has been done, but whenever we do the laser treatment, the adequacy of the treatment we come to know only after a month or 6 weeks.
Yeah, you have to see a pigmentation which comes up.
When I am doing the laser for any tears, I usually tell them that. I tell them that we'll be doing it now, but we'll have to check the adequacy over the next 1 week, 1 month. We may have to do a little touch-up later. That's what the way I would probably.
Now, the same patient then went to Delhi, and he had a lattice degeneration in the other eye. He had pigmented areas of weak retina in the other eye, maybe with holes, and he wanted to do a LASIK. So he went to the LASIK surgeon, and the LASIK surgeon told him, well, I can do the LASIK very well, as long as your retinal surgeon certifies that you can do LASIK. So he went to Dinesh. So what does Dinesh feel about this?
Yeah. For lattices, the policy I do is, I actually tell the patient about the number of risk factors involved. If it's an isolated lattice, small lattice, peripheral lattice, pre-equatorial lattice, asymptomatic lattice, He said, look, it's not an issue. But the LASIK, since even in that situation, this is a different category altogether. This category, you'd probably say, go ahead and get it treated. But even in that situation, I'd say, look, prior to a LASIK, because LASIK per se involves a sudden increase in suction, and that can cause pull on the retina. So generally, we prefer to treat before we go ahead for the LASIK.
No, okay, now I got it treated from you. Yeah. But still, do I undergo the LASIK or do I not undergo the
LASIK?
You
can go ahead. Once the laser has been done, you can go ahead for LASIK.
I think what he says is very true. Many times in those situations, the patient is going to put it onto the retinal surgeon that you tell...
You tell me what you should do. So I think that's a fair enough thing that, you know, that you do the laser for the lattices, you can do the LASIK, but we need to keep on following you up again because you may develop new areas in the future.
You can tell them from the retina part of it, there's no issues. You'll have to check with your cornea person about the suitability in terms of corneal thickness. They'll decide about the suitability of it.
So now the same person shifted to Bombay, 10 years past, and he had been treated in the past, and he developed flashes and floaters. But everybody had told him that he's nothing now to worry about it. And he developed a detachment like this, and he went to Dr. Vatsal. And again, he had to travel again 3 days later. So what would you tell this patient?
Means on the treatment part.
Yeah. Means how would you convince this patient to undergo a surgery?
Right. It's a superior detachment. So I'll tell him that, look, this is like a time bomb. It can diffuse. You have to diffuse it.
Bombay
is all like Narendra Modi. You know, it has to be dramatic explanation. So you need to be treated at the earliest because this has to be given priority, especially if he's having fresh onset and complaint, you know. And I would give priority. So I commonly say that, look, there's a marriage in family and somebody has heart attack, what would you do? You'll allow marriage to get over and then go for heart attack treatment. So this is how I explain, you know, and convince him for the treatment.
So in this case, you would prefer to do the surgery either
buckling
the day or the next one or 2 days. Now, what would you choose? A buckle versus a vitrectomy? Would you choose it first? How would you explain to the patient the options between a buckle and a vitrectomy? Because he says that he's talked to his retina surgeon, Salil has treated him previously, and Salil says that a buckle needs to be done, while you may feel that this patient is pseudo faking and a vitrectomy would need to be done.
Could you just show the picture once again?
See, personal means I think here two issues are that personally what you feel should be done for the patient and how you put it across to the patient, you know. Personally, superior detachment, whether phakic or pseudophakic, I would still do single break, I would still do buckle, you know. Unless patient is very, has undergone multifocal or something. So if I am doing buckle, let me put it this way, then what I'll explain him is that this is a procedure we would be doing from outside and it's fairly simple with fairly accurate results. So I would prefer to do buckling. However, in case if it fails, then we can always go to the next option.
Yes,
how I would explain is that in my routine practice is that suppose I have difference of opinion with you, should I go to the court or should I first talk to you, you know? So obviously I'll say, no, you should talk to me first. Courts are always open. So I say it's like this, that if buckling which is done from outside does not settle, then we can go for vitrectomy.
So then the next question I ask you, doctor, that means that after a month, my eye, after your buckling, will it be normal?
So then you have to explain that, no, it may be red and it may be little inflamed, you know.
So do we explain that our eyes can become red and tend to be inflamed after buckling to each and every patient?
I, as a routine, do not do it. I would not.
Because very often these patients do have a cosmetic problem after the buckling.
I do tell them that post-operative, it's part of a surgical procedure. You are going to have some redness, watering. Pain is generally not an issue. First day, they'll have a discomfort. Redness, swelling and all just settle down in about 2-3 weeks' time.
Would you say if he does not ask you?
I would generally, yes. Generally, yes. I would.
Yes.
Usually, I have a book from that retina research from California. It gives everything, including the pain, redness, intraoperative complications. And I make it a point that my fellows may sit with the patient and read. And I tell them, this is how we have to counsel the patient. But one thing is very clear. After doing everything, if everything is fine, they forget everything.
Correct.
And if they're not fine, you just tell them, I already gave you this, they don't like it. But even for vision, I tell them, that a macular attach is a beautiful line which is there in my concern form also, that attach the macula, if there's a macular attach like this, and then there's a possibility that you can lose some vision in spite of successful surgery. And they don't understand that. Before the surgery, they never understand.
No, but it's a human.
I think Dr. Natarajan made a very important point regarding general counseling. Yeah. And that is, never tell a patient, I told you so.
Correct.
Exactly. You may actually reiterate the same thing again,
right.
But don't actually tell him, I told you so.
And
because
that
is confrontationist. Any confrontation with a patient is going to result in a negative outcome.
Yeah, we'll just go to the next slide. One second.
One more before that. In the last, we had a similar infection course in American Academy, and they put a buckle like this and asked, if it is an actress, who will do a buckle? 99% of Gore was the faculty, including Stanis, so everybody said they'll do vitrectomy. But I said, I'll do buckle. Because I think the question is, when we know that there's redness, and we cannot promise that. This is only for our own, as a surgeon, I'm saying. And we promise ourselves that we do the excellent tissue care, and the squint, the redness, all can be avoided, provided you're meticulous in dissecting the conjunctiva from conjunctiva to conjunctiva. So many times, a buckle, I like to do conjunctiva to conjunctiva only because of the cosmetics. Because if you don't strip the phenol properly, or if the cotton bud is the one of the fiber is left behind, that will be constantly retaining for even years. And even the suture is protruding out, so I put it behind. And then wherever possible, suture not required, I don't do. Even for conjunctiva nowadays, I don't put suture. So usually, they are white in about 3 weeks. Yeah.
There's one point that I just like, means this is something which needs discussion, is that the issue that was raised here is whether you should, how much should you tell
the patient?
Because at the end of the day, as actually what he said also and what he said, both Dr. Natarajan and Dr. Talwar, that if there's something goes wrong, it's not that because you have said it's going to help. So the fact of the matter is that, personally, I would not go into telling that I may be a little, red and things like that. I think the only thing that I generally follow, that's my general method, that whenever I see a patient, and see, sometimes what happens, patients come to you because they have some relative has been operated with your center for cataract and things like that. That is the way also people come to you. So one thing which I always make a very solemn face, and I tell them that, see, this disease is a different disease. It's not like cataract surgery. So please be understand that, and therefore, so that feeling, because let's face it, we are the only doctors who try to tell the patient, our behavior. You go to any other medical specialty and they talk with very, very, in a very solemn way to the patient, especially where the conditions are. Because as far as we are concerned, vision is the only casualty. For us, a gone, totally loss of vision is as good as a patient passing
dying
away in any other specialty.
Yes.
So I think that solemnity has to be conveyed to the patient. I don't think you need to spell out the facts.
No, because if you can take this too far. You're talking about redness. Do you tell the patient that your buckle can erode? Do you tell him you can get a buckle infection? Do you tell him that because of that, you could actually get a thysis also?
No.
So there is a limit to how much you will take this.
Let's not go both ways.
Either we are trivializing this, because congestion, it's not that he's not expecting. In fact, if you don't, the problem comes if you promise there will be no congestion.
Exactly.
Correct.
Exactly.
He's expecting congestion.
So he's only asking you one thing. Doctor, will my eye be normal? He keeps on asking
normal? Yeah. No, if he specifically asks you a question that, look, will the eye go red? Will this be?
No, then it's asks you only one question. Will my eye be normal?
Then you have to. I always tell no. Yeah.
I tell them,
it'll never,
read all the questions.
It's never going to become normal.
No, before operation, I tell them, I spend an hour. But after operation, I said, there's no point in talking. I'll not talk. And nowadays, that doesn't work. But now I tell them, my fellow will keep talking to you. I'm going to see some patients with your permission. And whatever questions my fellows are answering correctly, I'll allow them to continue. But if something, you are either the patient is attacking the fellow or fellow is something wrong, then I interfere and tell, no, see,
just,
this is what I told you. And all this is before operation. And
yeah.
The second is, as you rightly said, there's a question called will you ever remove a buckle? That's a question. So it mentions about erosion, it removes about infection, and they also say the what are the complications of vitrectomy? It says including lysis bulbi, losing the vision, and losing the eye. That means evisceration. So the fellow asked me, what is the meaning? When the, I think it's only losing the eye. I said, no, losing the vision. I said, you don't understand. The person comes with PL. Losing the vision is what? I said, I have nothing. I said, you have light. When you after operation, you lose light. And if you lose the eye, it means you look small. What will you do? I said, that every day I'm operating, several thousand. Many are doing well, they call me God. But when they don't do well, do you call me devil? I said, I'm not God and I'm not devil. I'm a good surgeon, that's all.
There's just one basic principle of counseling. I mean, I read this somewhere and since then I follow this virtually everywhere. And that is, when you're asked a specific question, you have to give a specific, truthful answer.
Yes. Okay.
Otherwise, you may not mention a complication that occurs, say, 1 in 2,000 or 1 in 5,000 cases. For example, and the example given here is, which is of USA, that apparently somebody asked that, look, the surgery on this eye for a vitrectomy, can it cause something, any problem in this eye? And the answer given was no. The patient got a sympathetic ophthalmia.
Yeah.
The judge actually punished the doctor, not because he said, why did it occur? He said, look, you were asked a specific question. Even if it was 1 in 200,000, you should have mentioned it's 1 in 200,000. If he hadn't asked this question, it did not matter.
So I think that's what all our patients ask us. They ask us only one question. Doctor, will my eye be normal afterwards?
No.
I think, you know, so that's the question which is asked
by everybody.
No.
So there the figures must be given that what are the success rates anatomically, which I normally tell them that for this procedure, the success rates for the first surgery are 70 to 80%. You go to the net, you'll get a figure of 90 to 95%, which is the result of multiple surgeries. So there is a situation where the first surgery fails. Those 20% of patients will get a second surgery, 50% of them will settle, so now you get a 90% success rate. And sometimes a third surgery is needed, you can go up to 95% success rate. This is anatomic. In terms of vision, you are normally not going to get full vision. But the improvement depends on how long you've had this detachment and how long the vision lasts.
So now
everybody should read that Malcolm Gladwell book on blink, which says there's a study on counseling. Like physician spends 15 minutes and another group of physicians spends 18 minutes extra. And the last question was, the surgeon asked the patient, do you have any more questions? Thank you, doctor. I've got all my questions answered. The problem in India is, when you go to the door, everything thik ho jayegana. So I tell them, come back, sit down, take the book, read again. And they get angry. I know that. They get angry in the mind. I said, no, I'm sorry, you have come to my hospital. And you come to where, I said, this is what we do in the US. And when you go to US, you listen there. You please listen here.
I think it has a cultural difference in the way we...
No. But same time, they want to fight with you also,
no,
if it goes wrong.
What I mean, the cultural difference I feel, is that, there it's a very cut and dried thing. Like, I mean, I'll give a very simple example. It's like, you know, what you talk about, these pre-nuptial agreements. Now, it's not as though, if you think of it in a way... You know, if you know what I'm talking about, if somebody is getting married, they have a legal contract before the marriage saying that if marriage has to be dissolved, how it should be handled, that I shall not part with my fortune, etc., etc. Now, if you think of it in an Indian concept, you would say that when you koi shubh kaam karne ja rahe hain, so why to, you know, so I think it's a little bit of, it's an art in the final thing. It's not, I don't think, and I guess also it depends on every patient, sir, you know, the kind of patient you're dealing with.
But that's what, that's exactly what we are saying.
Yeah, it's a more problem. With no PL also they want me to do vision.
Yeah.
PL also they want me to, so if with a 6-9 giant tab they want 6-6. So all that is there. So I think the expectations are more. That's why promise less, deliver more.
Yeah, Deepak, do you...
Yeah, I think that is a very important thing. Yeah. Because most of the times the reverse happens. And that should not happen.
No, I always tell them, I know my...
So, in fact, even, I mean, you have, if I have PVR, even if I think I'm going to be able to settle it, I'll say, look, you have a 50-50 chance.
Exactly.
I mean, whatever I actually think I'm going to be able to do, I actually give 20% less than that.
No, I remember Vatsal telling me, I can stick to 80% clear buckling. So, when the patient goes to Vatsal, he says 90, the patient says, he calls me and says, sir, he's
No. And then the best thing, I always say, like, we should have one common link, yeah, because we are easy. I mean, every day,
yes,
whether we talk or not, so many patients come because they are nearby, and even particularly not here. So I always say, no, he's done a first statement will be looking at this.
He's done a wonderful job.
Fantastic job done. He has severe actually. So what? Job is done fantastic. I mean, you don't have problem. You have problem because it's your scar tissue. It's not surgery.
So I have to thank many times because you make them read and they get scared and they come to ask for surgery.
No, my counselors tell me this, sir, itna kyun baat karta hai, sab log idhar ja raha hai. I said, no problem, I'm helping my other colleagues. I know I'm maybe the senior most operating, but still, I'm helping my other juniors, because I always tell last word, no guarantee. So that you operated my relative.
I think that's a very important word, because I think that's the word our Indian patients understand.
Yeah.
No guarantee.
Yeah.
For some reason they understand this word. The same patient, as we discussed, you know, he went to Dr. Natarajan with PVR, and Dr. Natarajan did an excellent job and settled the retina completely. He removed the oil also. And then patient still just says that, well, I can see now things, but I can't recognize faces. I can't read. His OCT is normal. Everything is normal. So he went to Dr. Vatsal Parekh. And he says, well, Dr. Natarajan operated on me and this is my retina. Why can I not see? So how do you convince the patient?
See, I would tell him that the surgery is excellent.